Welcome everybody once again. So we're going to start with the special session on the social stock exchanges. Thank you to Mr. Amarjeet Singh for kindly joining us, the executive director of SEBI. He's been a great friend of FICCI all these years. So thank you, Amarjeet, for sparing the time. There have been a few changes in the program and yet you have accommodated. Thank you, Ms. Vidya Shah, for being with us this morning to moderate this session with Mr. Singh on this very important topic. So I hand over to Ms. Vidya Shah for taking the session proceedings forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Jyoti, and it's my absolute privilege to be introducing Mr. Amarjeet Singh this morning. He's had a long career of over 25 years with SEBI. He is currently the executive director in charge of the corporate finance department and has over the last many years been spearheading a lot of effort around international regulatory initiatives. As he has an MBA and a master's degree in economic policy management from Columbia. The topic, of course, today around this exchange is one that is very close to my heart, because I run ADD Foundation, which is part of the ADWISE crew. And as we have known, particularly in the times of COVID, nonprofits as well as civil society organizations have been at the front line of serving communities, both in terms of a health as well as a humanitarian response. They have been the uncelebrated champions who have worked very hard at this time. This topic today about building a social stock exchange as part of developing a financing ecosystem for sector, much like we have in the commercial or the corporate sector, is something that is very exciting to me. I would love to now hand it over to Mr. Singh to a presentation, and then if we have time, we'd love to take some questions. Thank you, Mr. Singh. Over to you.
Thank you, Vidya, and good morning, everyone. It's indeed a pleasure to be part of this conference. I would like to thank FICCI for keeping this short session on social stock exchange. I think it's very timely because the report on social stock exchange is out and for public consultation. And also, I think it's very relevant, as Ms. Shah rightly put it, in the context of ongoing pandemic. I believe this report assumes greater significance. In fact, when we were working on it, we didn't know that it will turn out to be a very important topic going forward. So I have put together some slides. My presentation, if I could have the slides on the screen, please. So I believe I have the, I can't see the slides actually.
Raji, we need to share the slide.
Yeah, now it's fine. Now I have it here. So okay, if you can go to the next one, please. So just to give you a sense of, you know, what my presentation is about, it's broadly in three parts. First is, you know, I would just like to set the context of this report, then briefly talk about what exactly do we mean by social stock exchange, you know, just to clarify the doubts around interpretation of this relatively new term, social stock exchange. Then, you know, I'll dwell upon some of the key recommendations and key insights which the group had while developing its report. Next slide, please. So in terms of context setting, let me begin with a quick word about Indian securities market. As you all know, you know, our market is quite well developed. Our market cap as percentage of GDP was 80% before the onset of pandemic. We are one of the top 10 markets of the world. We have the world-class time-tested institutional infrastructure products practices and quality of regulation, which is acknowledged by various third-party assessments, you know, of IMF, World Bank, and ISO. And of course, you know, we have tremendous capabilities and experience which supports the market. Our professionals, Indian professionals, are in great demand both in Wall Street as well as in Dalal Street. So this is no news. I'm not telling you anything new. Point I'm trying to place is that we have a well-developed Indian securities market. Let me change the track a little bit. Next slide, please. Now, we have, you know, tremendous need for patient capital. If you look at the Human Development Index rankings, we rank poorly at 129 among 189 countries. In fact, you know, few days back only, a report was released by Niti Aayog on July 13, to be precise, and that report very clearly articulates that India needs 6.2% additional spending of GDP to achieve 2030 SDGs, which will amount to, you know, on a rough calculation, $200 billion per year. And the report also acknowledges that, you know, the COVID-19 has disrupted all the plans and timelines for achieving these goals. So the short point is, and the report underlines that, the conventional financial capital or the government spending will not be adequate. And we definitely need to explore additional avenues of capital. So you call it patient capital, social capital, philanthropic capital, by whatever name you call it, we need lots of additional sources of funds to achieve our SDGs by 2030. Next one, please. So now, you know, let me just try and connect the dots. First, I talked about a well-developed market. Second, I talked about the needs for a philanthropical capital. Now, the questions are, can we leverage our securities market strength for the benefit of the social sector? Can the well-developed market that we have facilitate raising of funds by social enterprises and voluntary organizations within the securities market domain? Can we develop some new structures and mechanisms? Or can we revisit some of the available structures and mechanisms and see how we can customize those structures to meet the needs of the social capital? Can we have associated regulatory framework, you know, in terms of eligibility norms for participation, disclosures, listing, oversight, etc. So these are the very, very relevant questions. This was actually our starting point when we started the work. And these questions actually translated into the TOR, terms of reference for the working group. Can we go to the next slide, please? So this is, you know, my perspective on the convergence, how the securities markets can converge with the social sector. If you see the, you know, the point of intersection that relates to funding, how Indian securities market can fund social sector, and that's where social stock exchange fits in. You know, if I can put it in the lighter vein, how a capitalistic institution of a stock exchange can shake hands with socialism, so to say. So this is where we are coming from. Can we go to the next slide, please? So we, as I said, you know, we opposed these questions, which I just raised to the working group, which was led by, this working group was set up by SEBI sometime in September last year. This was led by Shri Ishaat Hussain, and it had the benefit of expertise, you know, from very relevant people were there on the group, coming from the areas of social welfare, impact investing, stock exchanges, NGOs. We also had representatives from Ministry of Finance and Ministry of Corporate Affairs. And of course, you know, the genesis is, it all goes back to the statement of Honorable FM in her budget speech for financial year 1920, where she articulated the vision for a social stock exchange, and we, you know, drew strength from there and took this forward. Let me, you know, spend a quick minute on the working of the group. So it wasn't an easy task, let me say that. The reason is we didn't have many precedences globally. We checked Singapore, Brazil, UK, Canada. You will find some work has been done there, but to our mind, that was not adequate, that was not enough. So we've actually stepped up on whatever global wisdom which was available, and we've gone far beyond that, and we did some hard thinking in the process of coming up with our recommendations. We also had a number of rounds of interactions with various stakeholders, NGOs, impact investors, and you know, the foundations and so on. So the report was finally submitted around end of May, beginning of June. So we made it public on 1st of June. Next, please. So now, you know, I think it's very important to get the basics right. So what is a social stock exchange? What do we exactly mean by it? And how should we visualize it? You know, since the report has been there, and also during our interactions with various people, I realized that, you know, it means different things to different people. Some stakeholders were of the view that moment it comes, all their problems will be solved. This is like a magic wand which is coming up. So I think it's very important to get the basics right. Otherwise, you know, we'll end up making the mistakes which were made by you know, we have that famous parable, a group of blind men trying to describe an elephant. Next one, please. So what is a social stock exchange? The way we have envisioned this is not a separate stock exchange. Proposal is not to set up a separate stock exchange. Proposal is to set it up as a separate segment under the existing national stock exchanges. It, in some sense, it goes beyond the conventional understanding. It's not a place where one can just go and simply raise money through the conventional instruments of equity and debt and list and trade. It is not that also. There is some scope for listing of for-profit enterprises, but that's very limited piece in the overall scheme of things. So the committee has taken a very holistic view when, you know, visualizing the social stock exchange. And its vision is that it is a combination of, it's a very dynamic sort of combination of various structures, mechanisms, and processes within the securities market domain. I must emphasize that within the securities market domain, what are the various structures, mechanisms, processes which can be tweaked, or some new mechanisms can be introduced to, you know, take this concept forward. So to my mind, I think it's obviously a new idea, relatively new idea. It's an evolving concept, and I believe it has a tremendous potential if we get all the pieces right. So in fact, I would encourage, you know, those who are watching this to read the report. And in the interest of time, I can't go, you know, much deeper into these details, but it'll be interesting if you read and understand, you know, what exactly do we mean by a social stock exchange. Next one, please. Now let me turn to the some of the key recommendations. So working group has actually, you know, come up with a range of recommendations which mainly focus on fundraising for organizations which work towards realization of social welfare objectives. So when it comes to fundraising, the way group has divided its recommendations. It's in two parts. One set of recommendations relates to non-profits, and the other set relates to for-profits. So in terms of the non-profit organizations, there is a recommendation for one new instrument. It is called zero coupon, zero principal bonds, where there is no expectation of return. It's almost like a donation certificate, which a NGO can issue, and the funders will purchase that. But it is linked with, you know, certain disclosure requirements, which I'll come to later on. So those disclosures are totally in terms of the social impact. Here, the return, social return, becomes more important than the financial return. You have an investor who is willing to, you know, let go the financial return, and who is expecting a social return, which will be monitored and disclosed through the reporting standards, which are enshrined in the report, and a very important piece there. Then, you know, there are two structures which are already available. One is a mutual fund structure, and second is social venture funds. In the mutual fund space, some of you may already know, you know, HDFC runs a scheme where the investors agree to forego their financial returns, either in part or in full, and they authorize the scheme to invest their returns to cancer society. I think it's a very simple, beautiful structure. I really like it, and I think there's a need for more of such funds. Quantum also has a similar sort of a fund. So it's very easy to understand where the retail investors can contribute to a cause while staying invested in a mutual fund, where they agree to, you know, forego part of their returns for a social cause. Social venture funds are AIFs, Alternative Investment Fund Category 1s, which are registered with SEBI. So this refers to the schemes which are registered with SEBI. And there, by design, these funds are authorized to invest in social ventures. And social ventures includes nonprofits. And within the, you know, the fund details, I mean, the regulatory structure that we have, these funds are allowed to accept grants from various, you know, donors, foundations, and so on. And they are also authorized to give the grants out. But somehow these structures have not been used so far. So the group has recommended that, you know, this funds, social venture fund regulations relating to that should be revisited, and we should see how, you know, we can take it to the next level. And there are some tweakings in rules which has been suggested. Then there are pay for success kind of structures, which the report has considerable details on this. And, you know, I'll just briefly mention here the, you know, you could have a structure where you have an outcome funder who will invest against the, only if the outcomes related to the project are achieved. And we have one successful example, Educate Girls. This is a DIB or a SIB, Development Impact Bond, or a Social Impact Bond. I think this is a beautiful success story in Rajasthan. Again, this is detailed in the report, and I would, you know, suggest those who are interested can read it there. Moving on to for-profit, just to go back, you know, on the pay-for-success model, the report also links these structure to social venture funds in terms of, you know, the investments by social venture funds in the DIBs. For-profit enterprises, this is another, you know, very distinctive feature of the report. These enterprises, what distinguishes these enterprises is that they have to very clearly state that for them, social returns are more important than the financial returns, and they agree to certain disclosure standards in that regard, and they can raise money through equity, or social venture funds can also invest in FPEs. Next one, please. So, you know, the now I think I'm coming to the very important piece in the report, that is the minimum reporting standards. I think this is a very important dimension which relates to disclosure and transparency. My perception is that it is generally agreed that there is a need to enhance trust and accountability in the space of social sector, and that comes in the way of attracting investments. So the report suggests certain common minimum reporting standards for both non-profits as well as for-profits, you know, which are seeking to raise money from the social stock exchange platform. So the idea is that minimum reporting standards will act as a filter in selecting the social enterprises which will be eligible to raise money from this platform. So what are the different dimensions of reporting? Basically, the emphasis is on point B in the slide, on the social impact scorecard. So there are three dimensions in terms of the reach, in terms of the depth, and in terms of inclusion. So these are some very distinctive disclosure requirements around these dimensions. Let me also mention, you know, there are various metrics which are available for such disclosures today. But our idea here is not to make it onerous, but to make it more, let the disclosures be more thoughtful, more outcome oriented, so that one can relate to it very clearly. So let me also emphasize that the disclosures here are from the perspective of the beneficiaries, intended beneficiaries, which the nonprofit seeks to serve. So if you ask me, you know, my view is this is one of the most important recommendations made in the report. And this can be a potential game changer in the social sector space if it is implemented rightly. Next slide, please. So the group is mindful, you know, these reporting standards may be a bit of an ask, and it may not be possible to implement fully from day one. So the report outlines a pathway of implementation. So in the immediate term, there is a requirement only in terms of self-reporting by the social enterprise, which is coming into this space. In the intermediate term, we envisage self-reporting will have to be supplemented by third-party verification by social auditors. And the ideal end state where, you know, we would like to reach over 4 to 7 years, where you have a self-reporting plus a full third-party verification by social auditors. But, you know, these are all tentative sort of outlines of the pathway that we foresee, but it's subject to change, subject to, you know, I would personally like to see it happening faster than 7 years, but this is what the group has outlined. Next one, please. So, another important piece in the recommendations is on the institutional side, on the enabling ecosystem. And this comprises of information repositories and social impact auditors. We already have information repositories and to some extent, social audit is also there, so the report foresees, you know, this to be taken to the next level. The group suggests that these institutions should be nurtured and taken to the next level. In the initial stages, we foresee that the registration with IRs will be optional, but it will add a lot of value if an NGO is registered with the IR, and IR gives, you know, some good information about the NGO. Similarly, for validation by social impact, validation of social impact using auditors will be optional in the early years, but going forward, this takes you know, more of a mandatory. In the end state, at the end of 7 years, we see that this will be a mandatory requirement. We've also recommended, you know, creation of a capacity building fund of rupees 100 crores, and a capacity buildings unit will be created as a part of the social stock exchange platform, and that fund and that unit will focus on, you know, building awareness about the social stock exchange. It will help in you know, further evolution and implementation of the common minimum reporting standard. It will also, you know, organize IRs, maybe by way of a SRO, to assist the social stock exchange in such implementation. It will also assist, I think it will be very useful, particularly for the non-profit organizations, in navigating their way through the social stock exchange system. Next one, please. So, for-profit enterprises, again, there are a number of recommendations. So they will be listed the way we foresee they can issue equity. They will list, and SEBI will come out with the listing requirements. However, idea is not to lower the thresholds. In fact, idea is contrary. Either, you know, idea is to have some very good quality companies coming into this segment. So there will be no compromise on the listing standards which are yet to be worked out. This would be probably existing listing requirements plus something to be eligible to list through this segment. What distinguishes these FPEs in the social sector space, as I was alluding earlier, is their richer impact narrative. So their preference for social returns, which has to be stated upfront, and they should have some sort of a track record of creating social returns. Again, the minimum reporting standards will apply to them. Actually, they can do more than minimum since they are for profits. And in addition to that, all other disclosure requirements which are applicable to any other listed company under LODR will apply to them also. So when we were doing this piece, there were concerns from some stakeholders. There still are, I suppose, that how about the regulatory arbitrage? Because, you know, all these actors which we are envisaging, there would be certain incentives in terms of tax, etc. At least that's the way the group has foreseen. There would be certain incentives for them to be in this space. So can there be a regulatory arbitrage opportunity, you know, in terms of moving from the main board to the social stock exchange segment? So we are very mindful of that at an early stage. So we've thought of, you know, keeping a close watch as and when it develops, and we'll handle it through listing criteria, through having stiff penalties for violations, through, you know, social audit, maybe mandatory even at an earlier than the NGO stage, and a careful scrutiny of cases which transfer from SSC to the main board. But having said that, you know, this piece again has tremendous potential in terms of, you know, its ability to attract impact investors, and I suppose there's a huge potential out there. Next one, please. So I think next one is my last slide. So this one deals with CSR and tax incentives. There are certain recommendations on how CSR spending, which is mandatory, how it can be linked to social stock exchange segment. So one is that these funds can be allowed to be used in zero coupon, zero principal bond, and other funding structures. These funds could also be used for the capacity building, 100 crore fund, which I referred to. And another very interesting suggestion out there is allow trading of CSR spends, where a corporate which has overspent can be reimbursed by a corporate which has underspent, and there could be a trading platform to facilitate that. Then also, you know, allowing CSR expenditure towards SSE to be tax deductible. There are a host of tax-related recommendations which relate to investors, donors, nonprofits, social enterprises, and the social stock exchange itself. In conclusion, that's all about the recommendations. These are some of the key areas which I've touched upon. I think just to sum up, I believe we have a high quality report, and you have to excuse my positive bias because I've been involved in this work right from inception. And the report aims to bring the social sector closer to the securities market, and that is the vision which Honorable Finance Minister also articulated. So I think it's a very concise work. It is rich with new ideas, new thoughts. It lays down a vision, and it charts a well thought out roadmap for reaching the end state. It also provides distinct pathways for various segments within the social sector. Outcomes, you may ask me, what is the way forward? So the outcomes of this, these recommendations would entirely depend upon how successfully these recommendations are implemented, and which in turn would, you know, require active contribution from all stakeholders. It is not just SEBI alone. There are a number of stakeholders who will have to work together. A lot of coordination required. A number of ministries are involved. So just to conclude, we are currently seeking public comments on this report, and the last date for giving comments is August 15. Those who are interested, just feel free to write to us. All the details are there on the website. I think since it's a new idea, more we hear on the subject, I think that will enrich our thinking and thought process for taking it forward. So thank you for your time and patience.
Thank you so much, Mr. for your really detailed and thoughtful exposition on the social stock exchange. I'm personally very, very excited because I think a lot of the issues that small and medium-sized and even the large nonprofits face in terms of funding constraints and funding challenges, we are really finding a way to address this in a very systematic and institutional way. You may know that recently, for example, the Ford Foundation in the US raised $1 billion in social impact bonds because there is a funding crisis everywhere because corporate profits have seen a big hit and endowments have seen, you know, tremendous diminution in value. I would really encourage a lot of our colleagues here today to provide the feedback that Mr. Singh is asking for, because we really need this to become, you know, a long-term viable and indeed show India as a, you know, as an exception to the rule about, you know, having formulated an extremely viable source of institutional funding for nonprofits. I'm also personally very excited about the pooling mechanisms that are available through the funds. And I wish, all the success, Mr. Singh, to this incredibly, exciting venture that we will all embark on. Thank you so much for spending your time this morning with us. And I look forward to, meeting you very soon. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.